and as a school.
Thank you for attending the session. So my presentation is going to be on big data beyond the classroom in an education environment. So what can we do with big data other than classroom? Who are we and what we are? Concordia International High School is a K-12 international school that's located in Pudong, Shanghai. Just a map to see where Shanghai is. K-12 school that is accredited by WAS. We run the American High School program. We do the AP courses. Student body of about 1,200 students, catered mainly for the expatriate communities. It's also because for an international school to operate in China, you've got to be a foreign passport holder. So we actually teach the whole course in English. So it's like a school in the US, but it's just that it's located in Shanghai.
So Peter, all the students have foreign passports?
They've got to have a foreign passport. They've got to have a non-Chinese passport. Yeah, so whatever that means, because you could be opening Hong Kong or Taiwan. Right, so, well, some of them actually will have their kid born out of China and then move back just for that purpose. So in my presentation today, there are actually three parts to it. I'm going to talk about the big data analytics, and then there are actually two other colleagues of mine who's been talking about big data in the AP course and in the counseling department as well. Unfortunately, two of them can't be here for this, so we have a video recording of their presentation. So let me just briefly talk about my big data analytic course at Concordia Shanghai. I've been teaching this course for 3 years now, as I briefly mentioned earlier on that I pioneered this course at my school 3 years ago because there's a need for it. And with the demand and the interest in it, last year we actually offered it as a distance learning course, and Rio, our student who's sitting at the back there, is one of my pioneer students.
Rio
just flew in from Hanoi yesterday to do her presentation afterwards. So at Concordia Hanoi, there were three students in it. So what I did was I flew down to Hanoi to start the to kickstart the program, and then after that we do online Skype calls and emails working with Google Docs. And it was because there's a demand for it, but there's no instructor for it. However, because there's an interest in big data analytics course at Concordia Hanoi, so they found a teacher to teach it, who's actually my ex-colleague. So he's going to be teaching it next year, and I was just told by Rio that she's going to be taking a big data analytics part two next year. So we are getting a support and an interest in this area. Now, as I mentioned earlier in my course, I teach them the conceptual understanding to big data analytics. Briefly during the break, coffee break just now, some professors asked me, do you teach them programming and things? I don't, because there's really no time for it. My job right now is to actually just teach the concept of what big data analytics is, expose them to the concept of it, but the important component to it is the project. And so as Michelle and Alan was talking about, what's the best way to evaluate your students' understanding, knowledge and skills? It's not about writing an exam. Writing an exam simply tells me that you're a good exam taker, but a project will tell me if you truly understand the material. Can you present it? So over the years, my students have to do a big data analytics projects, and these are some of the work that they're doing. Big data in microcredit, and this student, when she was a ninth grader, she started a microcredit company in China. And how does she evaluate it? She collects data on when they make the phone calls, all right? Do they pay their payments on time? So if they have got bills, electricity bills and so on, and if they are if they make their payment timely, it tells me that you are a responsible person. So she tracks these data that are outside of her just simply borrowing money, but collecting all this relevant data to determine if that individual is worth lending money to. I've got students who are in the physics master's class in particle physics. Okay. And Casey was looking at engineering, got a student back then, looking at engineering colleges that have the statistics on that. So over the years, my students have presented in Vegas, Puerto Rico, UK just in January, and now in Langkawi. So this is a picture of our most recent presentation in the UK in January that was hosted by Richard. Aaron there is the chess master, and Grace is the one who helped me to develop the big data for middle school. So as you, the question that came up earlier was, how do you ask the question, how do I get the students interested? I talk to them, I develop a rapport with them and find out what their interest is. And I want them to do a project that they are interested in, not me. They are the one doing the work. Grace is aspired to be a kinder teacher. So that's why I wanted to bring her in to talk about, to help me to develop big data analytics for middle school. As I was talking to Jala last night, and I said, why do I want to bring her in? Because I may not be able to speak their language. I may not be able to talk at their level. But the fact that she has taken my course, she understands what I want, my objectives, my goals, but she can craft it in such a way that I develop it in the way that students of that age group will understand. So that's why it's important for me to form the partnership with my students on it. And in this course, we have international guest speakers. We have Paula from IBM University, who ran over last year from Canada to give a presentation on big data analytics. We have Syed and Leo from IBM to do workshops at our school. So although we are just a K-12 high school, but the caliber of our students are very high. They are almost like undergraduate. The work that they do are phenomenal. Now, so with that, someone asked this question, right? Is it about the question or the answer? It's always about the question. You need to ask the right question. Stop it. And the answers will come along. So what are some of the questions that we want to ask outside of the classroom? Working with the administrators, we were looking at, there are about 11 to 15 international schools in Shanghai. The piece of the pizza is only so big. How can I get a bigger slice of the pizza? We need to understand where our students are going to. What are they looking for? What does that school have to offer that we don't, or what do we have that they're coming to us? So we were looking at students' enrollment in the Shanghai area. And what we found out was that there were things that we can do. I did the analytics, pass it on to marketing, and told marketing, I said, this is your target. We applied predictive analytics to it. This is the target enrollment that you would want to achieve next year. And we did. Now, other than student enrollment, bringing back to more closer to the school itself, we run K-12. The question that we want to ask is, in terms of attrition, which grade level has got the greatest effect on the enrollment? Now, I'm not talking about the one with the most enrollment or the least. I'm talking about who is the one that has got the greatest factor, the greatest drive to it, or the pluses and the minuses. It's not about the grade level. A lot of people misunderstand this and say, with the most students. It's not that, it's the one that drives your enrollment. All the pluses and all the minuses, the attrition rate. And we use Watson Analytics to do it. And to those of you, how many of you use Watson Analytics here? You know there's a function in the predictive, and it gives you the predictive strength. That's like your magic. You hit the button and it tells you which grade level has got the greatest effect. I don't need to know about the math, but you hit the button, it will tell you what the predictive strength is. It's almost like my magic bullet. So we did that, and we identified which grade level. So from the marketing point of view, we want to see how we can actually improve on that or to do more work on that. At a high school level, my principal had the interest on, because we are a college prep school, we run the AP, the college board courses. A lot of the Chinese parents or clientele, they go for just the top schools. But are AP courses a predictor for US elite school applications? Is there a correlation between the AP courses that you take, the AP physics, AB, BC, is there a correlation between that and the elite schools they get accepted to? So that was one of our questions. We're still in the process of finding, looking for the answer because our database is not big enough. So it's about the question. This thing is still brewing at the back of the administrators and the counselors' mind. Now, so I started this course about 3 years ago. Lo and behold, College Board has got a new course last year called AP Computing Science Principles. And in there, there is a module on big data analytics. See how the College Board is beginning to recognize that we have to teach big data in K-12 now. So we're gonna watch a video here.
I asked this question, and I see AP Computer Science Principles here at Korea International School, Shanghai. Now, in that course, there's a whole unit dedicated to big data. Operating teams of four, my AP Comsci Principles kids conducted research into topics of their choice, applied big data concepts and tools, and presented their findings formally. As this program matured, these presentations will increasingly be conducted for an authentic audience of scholars and business leaders such as yourself. Presentation skills are seen as fundamental to big data here at Concordia because communicating complex concepts effectively in a concise, clear, and understandable manner is necessary if these big data findings are going to be applied in a meaningful way. So thank you for allowing us to present what we
due to a controversial result of the U.S. presidential election of 2016, we wanted to explore the underlying components that resulted in President Donald Trump's victory. And although our research could not have been fully comprehensive due to each voter's individual preferences, we utilized various programs to analyze and predict the outcomes.
We were primarily interested in the amount of food being wasted and the numbers of starvation in many of these developed countries. So that brought us to research how and why food was being wasted.
We wanted to have a topic that could be looked at from a variety of perspectives. We looked at how life expectancy was affected by income, child mortality, environment, and gender. In addition, our world is rapidly developing in the technological, agricultural, and business fields. We wanted to take a look at how these variables impact life. We used Google Public Data Explorer to get statistics on the U.S. population. We also used Smart Online Calculator to visually graph the linear graph that was derived from us.
We used various databases, but in MOU, we used the Google Public Data Explorer, the Food and Agriculture Organization, and the World Resource Institute.
We used the Gapminder website graph creator tool to make our interactive and animated graph. Which was very helpful because it allowed us to make changes to the X and Y axes in order to do our research ideas. It also has circles of different colors and sizes that show more information than is explicitly presented, not only teaching more, but also making a less boring graph. To create our presentation, we used Google Slides, QuickTime Player to record our screen, and the Decimal Grapher for our linear regression. Initially, we used automated summarization to digest the possible factors that went into the voting decision and the process. And then we used linear regression to draw a line of best fit that predicted future trends and how they would progress. We also used clusterization to group regions of the United States to better analyze clusters. We also used measures of central tendency, such as mean, median, and mode, to look at central measurements of categories such as income, voters, race, gender, and age. We use a variety of strategies, including linear regression, anomaly detection, automated summarization, and comparisons between graphs. In one aspect of our presentation, we use the transitive property between different variables to show correlation.
Initially, we used automated summarization to gain a broad knowledge on the concepts related to the election. We then concluded with some areas of research to go further in depth on gender economic status and votes. We used linear graphs to show the gender gap clusterization chart to show mean personal income and a bar graph to democratic votes.
So we started out by choosing to use powerful visuals, simple visuals, to get our point across, because it's very easy to get caught up in an image. And as the saying goes, picture speaks a thousand words. We also use graphs to show exact percentages and to visually show what is going on in specific countries and regions.
For our subject, we thought it was most efficient and appealing to present our research using animated graphs showing changes in life expectancy over time, based on four different factors. These included income, child mortality, gender, and environment. One for each member of the group.
We went about practicing presented information by practicing with each other and practicing what we are going to say and how we are going to say it. We wanted some information to stick out more than others, and we did that by practicing specific pausing and pacing for our students.
We practiced individually at home before meeting together in class. In class, we connected a team member's laptop to the projector and went through our presentation as if it was the real thing. Although we were not able to do the whole thing, it gave us a sense of what to expect when presenting to our large class.
We geographed contradictions in our research and concluded that wealthier states seemed like they were supposed to vote for Hillary Clinton, but instead, the wealthier people voted for Donald Trump. With the research, we concluded that 80% of the top 15 states for median income were blue states, meaning that they voted for Clinton. But, according to the exit poll, Edison Research, Clinton had the majority of voters on lower income. We busted the misconception that without big data, we could not have found.
We learned that using big data is actually not that difficult to do. If you're focused on finding the correct information and the information that pertains the best to your project, then the project becomes relatively easy to do, and the use of that information becomes fast, and you are able to point out specific things that would have been almost impossible to connect without using big data.
With this data, we learned how the environment, income, gender, and child mortality are affecting our life expectancy. We can use this data to fully change our habits as human beings so we can develop longer lifespans. Although this may seem unrealistic, it is critical that we are aware of the effects of our actions.
By the way, that was all student produced.
Very impressive.
All right, so that was what Chris Carter did with his AP Computer Science Principle. Now, so beyond the classroom, my big data analytics course have captured the attention of the administrators and the counselors as well. So, what are the counselors doing with the data, with the student data? It's not just about the grades, but there's something more. From the counseling department, they were able to mine for more information to how to actually better support our students. And let's hear what Patrick Love has to say about analytics from the counseling department.
Hi, my name is Patrick Love. I'm a high school counselor at Concordia International School in Shanghai. Today I'm going to talk about data-driven student care and academic advising. As a counselor, I work to provide students with opportunities to grow socially, emotionally, and academically. The challenge I face is that I don't have the bandwidth to continually meet with and monitor each student's growth and wellness. However, this is also an opportunity. I found that I can creatively use technology and data to better understand students and their needs. I can create strategies to provide each student with individual developmental opportunities, and I can better advocate for student wellness and achievement in our school communities. I didn't exactly come up with this idea on my own, however. I first saw this happening at Stanford University, and here's an example on the left where they track students' experience of school over 2 years of graduate school. On the right-hand side, they also do this at Olin College of Engineering, and it's a student tracks his or her experience through 1 year of science class. I started doing this with our own students here at Concordia, and each Wednesday at 3 o'clock, they complete a survey with 7 questions, and it takes approximately 3 minutes. I'll quickly take you through that survey so you have a better understanding of it. First of all, we ask if there's any reason students want to meet with the counselor. We ask them about their happiness and contentment. We ask about the stress level that they're under and whether it's good stress or bad stress. We ask how many hours of sleep that they've had in the last 24 hours. We ask how many highly challenging tests, quizzes, assignments, or co-curricular activities they've had to complete in the past 24 hours and in the upcoming 24 hours. We ask about their motivation level and the quality of their relationship. We have a second survey that we ask students to complete twice per year, once each semester. And this is a homework survey. It has 11 questions, and it asks about the amount of homework they have to complete for each of their classes. Now, Google Surveys and Google Spreadsheets provide us with the results of these surveys, but it's not exactly helpful in giving us information we need to monitor students' progress throughout the year. It gives us results that look like this. It can give us kind of a broad perspective, but it doesn't help us really zero down on individual students and their experience in school. For that, we use Tableau. Tableau is a really powerful product that helps us to really understand and visualize our data. And here I'm going to go ahead and explain the wellness information that we have and the homework data that we have. So this is what the information looks like in Tableau. And we can connect to our Google survey information and import it right into Tableau once our data visualization has been set up. This is the response to the student questions, starting with motivation, happiness and contentment, stress, good or bad stress, and sleep. And along the bottom, you'll see the different graduation grade levels with seniors, juniors, sophomores, and freshmen. We can also look at the data on a week-to-week basis. Again, looking at when are students getting the most sleep, when are students getting the least amount of sleep. And we can also look at individual results, looking at which students are the most motivated, which students are least motivated. Each of these are sortable, so I can look at the most motivated students, the least motivated students, and I can look at that for all of these different areas. When we look at homework, we can look at the amount of homework by each class, and I can sort that from the greatest to the least. I can look at how that breaks down for the classes, for the grade levels in each class. I also ask students how much time they spend doing homework on average, and the amount of focus or energy they have during that time, as well as their commute time. I can also look at each student, and I can look at how much time they're spending for each course. And that stacks up so I can see a full picture of how that student's spending their time on their homework. I can also see their AP, the amount of homework time for AP classes and non-AP classes as well.
So that's basically just talks about how the counseling department uses big data analytics. And that's our presentation. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Peter, for